Welcome back, everybody. Thank you very much for joining us this month for another session of the Ecosystem Restoration webinar series presented by the CEM Restoration Thematic Group. We will have time at the end of the question and or at the end of the series for question and answers. If you have any questions during the presentation, feel free to type those into the chat box, but we'll get to that at the end. For today, we have our first regional update from the CEM region of South Asia, and we are very pleased to have Shalini Dayani here. She is the CEM South Asia Regional Chair, and then she also works at the National Environmental and Engineering Research Institute in India. So without further ado, we're going to get a regional update from Shalini Dayani. As I mentioned, she's the South Asia Regional Chair, and we're very happy to have her as our first regional update. It's a little bit of a summary of her talk today, and I will actually let her introduce herself in her own way, as well as set the stage for her presentation today.
Hello, Brooke. Thank you for having me here on one of the regional webinars for sharing restoration experiences, especially from South Asia. So happy to be here and looking forward to share experiences. I am Shalini Dhyani. I am basically from India, right now sitting in a central part of India in one of the very hot cities, Nagpur. And we just received our late monsoon showers. And I'm a scientist with National Environmental Engineering Research Institute. It is one of the research institutes by Council for Scientific and Industrial Research of India. And I also wear the cap of IUCN South Asia Chair for Commission on Ecosystems Management. My core interest lies in forest ecosystems, urban ecosystems, as well as restoration and impact assessment studies. I bring with me almost more than 1.5 decades of work experience that has focused on Indian Himalayan region and now in central India and parts of coastal areas of Odisha on the west, on the east coast of India. So this is a brief about me, and we are also having a lot of outreach programs to CEM in South Asia. So welcome once again to all the participants and audience for this webinar from different parts of the world. I really welcome you to share the experiences from South Asia. And as I shared, my restoration experiences will be coming from different organizations and different individuals, practitioners on ground who have been working to restore ecosystems across South Asia, but especially from Nepal and India. The topic of my presentation is developing community partnerships for addressing long-term and successful restoration efforts, lessons from South Asia. So just coming on a bit of overview on South Asia. I'm sure all the participants here are well aware about the geographical location and all the countries that are part of South Asia. But South Asia Commission on Ecosystem membership is for countries that are mostly from Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Maldives, Nepal, and Sri Lanka, whereas Pakistan, Afghanistan, that are also part of South Asia, and China are part of other region of IUCN. And if we see IUCN program of 2017 and 2020, South Asia has been considered as a region that requires greatest conservation need because of a lot of factors and a lot of reasons. The first important reason is this is biodiversity hotspot. And second important reason is it is also hotspot for indigenous communities. So biogeographically, if we see, this is one of the most diverse areas and in the world, and it has many biodiversity hotspots, but especially to mention few of them like Indian Himalayan region, Western Ghats, and then Andaman and Nicobar Islands. And this area is also rich for its long coastal diversity of mangroves, then a lot of marine diversity in terms of fishes, corals, and a lot of migratory aquatic and marine fishes and animals. Then at the same time, this area is also having a high socio-cultural diversity because of the largest indigenous people population that is residing in many parts of South Asia, and also some of the most indigenously managed landscapes and seascapes are also part of South Asia. So if we talk about Nepal or Indian Himalayan region or Western Ghats or island, some of the most indigenous communities are part of this very biodiversity rich landscape. But the matter of concern is also that this area is having the globally most poorest of poor population, and poverty eradication has actually resulted in a lot of biodiversity loss. So deforestation and unsustainable agriculture are one of the focused areas where a lot of land degradation has happened. And apart from that, for economic development, a lot of new industries like mining and thermal power projects or hydropower projects have also have their strong ecological footprint on the landscape and biodiversity of this region. If you show, if you can see this important statistical percentage area in the forest cover, you can see there has been a historical decline in last few decades. I'm not showing historical data, I'm just showing here what is the current status of forest in Bhutan, Sri Lanka, Nepal, India, and Bangladesh. And seeing the geographical area of the countries, this is not a very satisfactory and promising, the statistical area, the geographical area under forest. So now coming to the next slide that shows about the Intergovernmental Panel on Biodiversity Ecosystem Services findings of biodiversity and ecosystem services in South Asia by Asia Pacific Assessment that was released last year in Colombia. And I would be happy to share that a lot of IUCN CEM members from South Asia were part of different chapters of this report. And if we see the highlighted drivers that have threatened the biodiversity and ecosystem services of this area are especially climate change, land use change, overfishing, invasive alien species, waste and pollution. And in all the sectors and all the ecosystems, you can see a drastic increase in these drivers that have led to a reduction in deforestation, reduced biodiversity, and reduced flow of ecosystem services and benefits to the larger human well-being. So when climate change, land use change, and overfishing has already been talked a lot in all the international meetings and negotiations, a lot of consideration has also moved to invasive alien species, because now in last few decades there has been a massive encroachment of invasive alien species in larger landscape of South Asia that has resulted in tremendous loss of not only economy but also have resulted in loss of ecosystem benefits, because they encroach natural landscapes and result in loss of biodiversity from this area. So land degradation and land use change has actually resulted in loss of economic loss to the region. Being considered also in land degradation and restoration IBIS report that was also released in 2018 in Colombia, land degradation has been considered one of the major issues for South Asia, because it has also been economically assessed that land degradation causes almost $10 billion of loss every year to the entire region. India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, Afghanistan, Nepal, and Sri Lanka, Bhutan are the countries that are losing at least $10 billion annually because of the results coming from land degradation because of various reasons. And this is almost equivalent to the gross domestic product, or 7% of the value of its total agricultural product. So when I talk about different type of factors that are causing land degradation in the region, the first important category is natural hazards. So natural hazard because of heavy rains, because the region is facing extreme events in a very frequent manner in last few decades. So recently there was Phoni, the cyclone that hit one of the east coast states of the country. Then we have extreme steep slopes in many parts of the country. So landslides, because landslide is a common problem. Then soil erosion, acidic soil is also one of the reasons of loss of fertility of soil, and that leads to land degradation. Then arid climate in the region also leads to salinization and lowering of water table. Also, a lot of agriculture is groundwater dependent, that results in loss of ecosystem benefits. The second important factor that was considered for land degradation in the region is basically humanly caused region. So these are like deforestation, overgrazing, improper crop rotation, non-adaption of soil conservation practices, unbalanced fertilizer use, mismanaged irrigation, overpumping of groundwater, etc. And the third important feature that very much is significant for South Asia is underlying causes of degradation, basic socio-economic conditions, pressures on forest, and poverty of local people. So the socio-economic driver is one of the hidden but most important and one of the strongest driver that is leading to land degradation in many parts of South Asia. Now, just showing you one of the not very recent but very significant this distribution of land cover that is I have sourced from University of Texas website. So if you see the extent of land cover changes, you can see the entire South Asia has undergone a massive land cover change because of agriculture or shrublands and then cropland. So there has been a lot of land cover changes in the area in last few decades. Then showing you a very recent picture of land degradation that shows that there has been a huge area that is highly degraded. So if you see, almost 30 to 50% is the extent of percentage area that is degraded and falling under different categories in South Asia, with especially India having a lot of highly degraded, almost 50%, and equivalent is the area that is degraded in different parts of the country. And if you see, many of these regions are falling in down south, then in the central part of the country, then in the western part of the country, and also in the northern part of country that is having borders with Nepal and Bangladesh. So when I talk about degradation and land degradation, so the most important thing is to understand the erosion. What were the major reasons of erosion in South Asia? So water erosion, wind erosion, fertility decline, water logging, and salinity ingress are some of the common factors that have resulted in land degradation. It is a very widespread, and the area has already encroaching and reaching a severe degree of land degradation in many parts of South Asia. And this is one of the figures that we have taken from one of the recent publication that shows that in Asia, China and India contain one of the most degraded areas in the world, with almost 490 million hectare under degraded category. So the predicted, most notably, the areas of severe deforestation and water erosion is in different parts of the region. The implication of degradation in South Asia is also considered by the global community, is because the implication of land degradation will also have severe consequences for the regions that are outside South Asia. So for example, the transboundary land degradation is going to affect other countries as well. So the land degradation in Himalayan nations is going to affect the rivers, the sediment that is coming from the rivers to Bangladesh and other countries that are neighboring and are sharing some of the areas, transboundary areas. When I talk about the specific countries in South Asia, so almost 140 million hectare, almost 43% of region's total agriculture land has suffered from one form of degradation or other. So this degradation can be a wind erosion or soil erosion, water erosion, fertility decline because of excessive use of fertilizer. So even recently, UN has said that India has one of the three important hotspots of nitrogen, the cascade effect on India. So three of them are in India. And there is a serious impact of excessive fertilizer use on agriculture that is eroding the soil quality for the longer time duration. Then waterlogging and obviously salinization in coastal parts of Bangladesh or India and is very frequent. And salinity, because of salinity ingress, a lot of crop production declines. That also affects the livelihood and human well-being on the coastal communities of the region. So if I talk about strongly degraded and moderately degraded areas, 31 million hectare of the region is strongly degraded, whereas 63 million hectare is moderately degraded in the region. And the worst affected areas are Bangladesh, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, Afghanistan, Nepal, and then India and Bhutan. So forest deforestation, forest degradation, grassland degradation, quarrying and mining, urban encroachment, agriculture, extension, and forest areas are some of the very common reasons of land degradation. But what has happened in the last one decade is that climate change coupled with anthropogenic intervention using a lot of cash crops or using shifting of some native trees with some more like economic species like rubber and bamboo and some other species have actually increased the severity of disasters that have happened in South Asia in last one decade. So some of them, most of them have been natural disasters, but the severity of that these disasters have increased tremendously. And the important thing that I would like to share is that in almost three decades or before, the disasters were mainly localized in natural areas that are more pristine in nature. But now the urban expansions and these sprawls are becoming the new hotspots of disasters because of a lot of encroachment of natural forest and other pristine lands and converting them into urban settlement. So increased population, change in land use, it has severely affected the region and also has increased the intensity of disaster. So here I'm sharing some of the pictures from recent Phoni that hit Odisha coast. And the intensity was so strong that there was a major damage to three of the main cities in Odisha. And on my right are two pictures that is showing landslide severity in Kerala. And this severity was very much talked last year in a lot of international media that due to a lot of land use changes and unsustainable activities, a lot of disaster intensity has increased in South Asia. Also, the Indian Himalayan region, the Nepal Himalaya and Hindu Kush Himalayas are very new and they are undergoing a lot of tectonic movement that also results in a lot of natural disasters in terms of earthquake and that leads to loss of forest and ecosystems. Why it is important to understand ecosystem degradation in context of South Asia is that it's not only an ecological issue, it's also a socio-ecological issue. So one kind of degradation not only leads to disasters but also leads to reduced flow of provisioning ecosystem, reduced benefits to communities and enhances women drudgery because in many parts of South Asia, women are the custodians of natural resources and also backbone of economy. So if they are hit, their education gets affected, their offsprings, their health and social environment also gets affected. So the vicious cycle of land degradation that is accelerated because of poverty has a significant impact on human well-being and their socio-ecological environment. So in totality, if we see the land degradation issue is very much required to be addressed at all levels from local to landscape to ecosystem to the larger level because the inherent water, energy and food nexus issues can only be addressed if restoration is appropriately and accurately addressed at various levels in South Asia. So the major challenges that have been identified these outcomes are based on some of our workshops and brainstormings in last 2 years in CEM. And we came out with identifying some of the major challenges. So the first important challenge that the South Asia region is facing is intensive agriculture practices, mostly cash crop practices that are leading to loss of indigenous crop diversity. So initially, what used to happen almost 3 to 4 decades before, that most of the crop diversity was indigenous in nature, and it has a lot of property to adapt to the changing climate condition. And it was also considered to be semi-agriculture. So that has property to improve soil fertility and also to withstand the extremes of temperature. But slowly the indigenous crop diversity that was also adaptive in nature has shifted to cash crop practices that required a lot of fertilizer input, lot of groundwater requirement. So that has resulted in land degradation. And there are so many areas in the country that are undergoing, in the region that are having zero groundwater or reduced groundwater scenarios. The second important aspect is developmental projects, especially mining, thermal power projects and hydropower projects. And they are basically developed on a lot of natural biodiversity rich areas. And these are also the areas, the resource rich areas, where poorest of poor of the countries are living. And the second important problem is growing urban sprawls that are mostly fragmented. And they are also leading to a lot of degraded landscape. And the fast lifestyle of urban locals is not very well adapted to understand and acknowledge the environment and ecosystem benefits that has led to a lot of land degradation, insufficient awareness about biodiversity and ecosystem services and their benefits. So unless that is very well acknowledged and understood, the first important thing is the HE targets will not be well realized. And second important thing is the land degradation issues will not be well addressed. The fourth important major challenge is poor understanding of species and its function and socio-ecological interlinkages. And that create a lot of issue when restoration practices are there or restoration projects are planned. So the idea is mostly to create greenery. So in that context, mostly species that are fast growing, high biomass yielding, and mostly invasive species are preferred. So a lot of introduced species are introduced in native areas. So that leads to a loss of biodiversity and are not good for ecosystem in long run. The fifth important aspect is rehabilitation, restoration, and afforestation, raising monoculture. So the social forestry program that has promoted a lot of monocultures of invasives in the region has also resulted in declining ecosystem benefits and degradation of areas. So monocultures, usually they don't allow other endemic and native species to grow and reduce ecosystem benefits as a result. Then monitoring and post-plantation care are some of the most important aspects. So plantation has been done on a very mass scale, but the post-plantation care for next 2 years in monitoring what is being planted where and what extent it needs post-plantation care is mostly ignored. So that are some of the crucial challenges for the region. So overall, what we could understand is when UN has already declared the ecosystem restoration decade from 2021 to 2030, to understand that it's very important for all the countries around the world to understand how much important is to restore the ecosystem so that we can live in harmony with nature. And at the same time, we can address a lot of SDGs, especially 1 on no poverty, 2 zero hunger, 3 good health and well-being, 15 life of on land, 12 responsible consumption and overall partnership for the goal. So these are some of the SDGs that are also projected by IBA's Asia Pacific Assessment 2018 and also very well framed and projected by Sendai Framework for Disaster Risk Reduction, Paris COP promises, and also to address the bond challenge promises that different countries of South Asia regions have made. So overall, we need to understand that there is a much sophisticated understanding required on contemporary trends of the subject, and it also requires a multidisciplinary approach. So far, for a larger region like South Asia and different kind of agro-climatic zones, one size cannot fit all the region, so there should be very specific planning of restoration attempts with specific species based on climatic climates following the natural course of succession. For different agroclimatic zones need to be prioritized, and this will require a multidisciplinary approach. So the task only done by biologists will not solve the issue. It has to be addressed by different subject experts coming from economics background or political background, geophysics background, hydrologist background, and socio-economic background. And this context is especially important because India is going to host the COP14 for UNCCD in September, and it will be a very vital place to discuss all these approaches happening across South Asia and what are the next course of action that South Asia region and other parts of the world need to decide on restoration and reducing degradation across the world. So now coming to sharing some of the success stories, and these are not success stories. A few of them are success stories at very local level, but there are many projects that have been planned at a very large geographical area and specific ecosystems that have been shared by different CEM partners, partner organization, as well as members from different parts of the region. And also to mention, these success stories and case studies have been implemented in different agroclimatic zones. So the inferences that we are getting from these case studies and research projects have been very significant to build up our knowledge on restoration in South Asia region, because all of them have tried not only to address the ecological issue of land degradation, but have also tried to address especially need-based conservation, need-based restoration in South Asia region. So the very first case study is on reclaiming flood damaged farmlands in Nepal, converting wasteland into garden. This study was shared with us by Dr. Madhav Karthi, and he also happens to be the deputy chair for CEM. So when we see Nepal at large, the situation and scenario of land degradation is very poor. 2/3 of the country's total area is geologically very, very fragile because of the tectonic activities that are still ongoing. Then soil erosion is exceedingly high. So you can notice a lot of soil degradation, landslides, floods, water-related issues in Nepal. And if we see the topsoil loss, almost 87 tons per hectare per year of sloping terrains are lost because of different reasons. So poor land management in Nepal is not only affecting the food production in the region, but is also leading to biodiversity loss, loss of carbon sink, and also leading to reduced disaster relief resilience. And it has been also said in IBBE's 2018 report that countries like Nepal will face greatest challenges, because these are one of the small countries that are living close, they are very close to mountains, and are at the same time are very disaster prone because of a lot of reasons. So this project is about adaptation at scale price project. Just telling a brief about adaptation at scale price project. This project uses financial incentives to stimulate and sustain transformational change in Nepal society. Activities involve working with already implemented, developed, and innovative adaptation practitioners and projects. So the scale of the project is to maximize the benefit for poor, vulnerable, and deprived population by improving their capacity to climate change. So that includes developing skills, developing knowledge to adapt to climate change in Nepal. And at the same time, this project also acknowledges a lot of great examples of community-driven initiatives that are successfully changing the lives of people for better in terms of climate change adaptation. And it's very important to showcase these studies at international level so that there is a possibility to scale up, as these are studies that are done by few communities and are limited to few geographical areas. This is also to encourage eligible organizations to develop new and innovative ways to scale up community-driven climate change adaptation initiatives. So this climate adaptation at scale prize was first of all started in 2016 as ideas to impact. And this was funded by UK Department for International Development. So the partners are IMC Worldwide, Institute of IDS Nepal, CGD Nepal. So this project not only builds food security for locals, but also develops a lot of climate resilience. So the first picture that you're seeing on your screen is about bank cultivation. Bank cultivation or riverbed farming is a very prominent practice that locals in living in the Tarai district of Nepal have recently started. So this district like Kailali district, Kanchanpura district, West Tarai areas of Nepal, and this is recently expanded to Banke and Bardia district, then Kapilvastu district of Nepal. So in these areas, what happens is after monsoon, when the water recedes, there is a lot of seasonal sand banks that are used by community to grow some seasonal vegetables. So you can see some of the examples of seasonal vegetables that are being sown during post-monsoon season. And before the next monsoon next year, these are harvested. So this not only reduces soil erosion in the area, but also develops a lot of opportunities for economic and livelihood benefits for the community. So this is a very good example of restoration at bank cultivation that also fulfills the livelihood opportunities. So this was started in 2016, and more than 700 farmers are involved in this kind of restoration approach in different Terai districts of Nepal. And right now, more than 4 km² of land has been regularly restored and rehabilitated and reduced soil erosion in this area by food security program of riverbank farming. So in local language, Nepali language, it is also called as bagar kheti. So bagar here means riverbed farming. So the next important example is the plantation and reclaimed land. So most of these lands are wastelands. So the plantation has to be planned according to communities. So recently what communities have started, they have tried to align these goals of plantation along with the global goals to develop sink and also to get livelihood benefits and also trying to sell some kind of carbon credits in voluntary markets. So this approach has recently started. So this is an ongoing project, and they are changing the reclaimed land into fruit orchard. So fruits they can sell and they can reclaim the land for their benefits based on their community desires, community needs. So if you can see few of the locations that are mentioned here, few of the villages, and there is also mentioned the area in Bigha that has been reclaimed. So Bigha is a very local area measurement unit. So 1 hectare is equal to 8.96 Bigha. And there are the number of plants, and the table also shows that the poorest of poor and marginalized untouchable communities and indigenous communities were involved with this entire program. So now moving to the next slide from Nepal that talks about bioengineering. Bioengineering for building resilience for climate adaptation and mitigation. So this is one of the very effective ways to control water disasters, because floods from the rivers that are originating from India like Kosi going to Nepal are one of the major reasons of flood. And these are controlled by riparian and upland plantation by communities. So most of the species that are planted are a species that can also yield them fuel wood, fodder, edibles, because fuel wood and fodder is one of the most requirements of the hill communities. At the same time, these energy demands help them with their agriculture and lifestyle dependent economy. So building resilience through control and at the same time also controlling water disaster by bioengineering approaches was recently been awarded by Climate Adaptation Awards. This is one of the next slides that shows some of the bioengineering approaches being utilized in the highlands of Nepal. And these species, if you can see in different slides, in one of the slides in the top, banana is grown for slope stabilization. So at one hand, banana helps in slope stabilization by root stabilization and reducing soil erosion. And the fruit of banana can be used to be sold in local markets and city markets. So that in turn motivates communities to participate in this entire program and help in restoration of slopes. At the other hand, you can see there is a lot of broom grass being cultivated on slopes. Broom grass is one of the very preferred species in Nepal, where it is used to restore ecosystems. And at the same time, the broom grass helps in developing livelihood initiatives by making brooms. So a lot of livelihood comes by these broom grass. Communities are involved in making broom and selling in local markets. And these are other related capacity building and skill development programs along with restoration, so that community and indigenous people feel motivated and get involved with the entire program. So they also develop a lot of skill by mushroom cultivation or different kind of livestock improvement programs or vegetable cultivation, other education programs, so that the community feels involved and motivated to contribute. Now coming to the other case study, two of the case studies that are shared by CEM partners from India, G.B. Pant Institute of Himalayan Environment and Sustainable Development. They are involved on transboundary landscape conservation and development initiatives in Kailash Sacred Landscape Area, that is a transboundary area shared between India, China, and Nepal. So this is a 31,000 square kilometer area, and ecologically very diverse area, very multicultural area, and at the same time very fragile. So it is located in the remote southwest part of Tibet, autonomous region of China, and far west region of Nepal, and northeast of Uttarakhand state of India. So in this landscape, you might see a lot of wetlands, forests, rangeland that have very specific components and very specific ecosystem benefits. And at the same time, Kailash Sacred Landscape conserves a lot of biodiversity of snow leopards, ungulates, and a lot of birds. So this is a very significant area. And this entire program has been running for almost a decade. And this is following ecosystem and landscape approach toward achieving conservation and sustainable development goals. The involvement of diverse group of stakeholders, this case study is specifically from the Pithoragarh district, that is part of Uttarakhand state of India, where the livelihood improvement program for people also helps in protecting the landscape and rehabilitating the landscape at many parts. So these are some of the common activities that have been taken care of in last one decade. You can see plantation, and this plantation is not only on scientific lines, on scientific knowledge, but also with people consultation, because there are a lot of species that are important for not only landscape, but also for people. So a joint consultation has resulted in improved plantation techniques by using indigenous and local knowledge system. So this has involved scientists, this has involved communities, this has involved youth and women. At the same time, apart from tree species, they are also using a lot of grasses to rehabilitate the landscape. This is very important, one of the technologies that has been developed by the institute. Sweet technology is the abbreviation. It's sloping watershed environment engineering technology. And this is the package aimed to achieve twin goals of restoration and also to enhance livelihood benefits of stakeholders. This package is an integration of simple technologies such as water harvesting, soil conservation, selection of suitable species by people's participation. And at the same time, because in these areas, it's not very frequent to get good plant nurseries, to how to raise nurseries, and some of the communities are also involved in nursery raising for lesser known underutilized species, and which according to them are very beneficial for their ecosystem and communities. So that has been one part of this program. Then biofencing and clearing, post-plantation care is very much part of this program. And in the last picture, you can see how this restoration has also helped revival of some of the local small streams of the forest areas. So this attempt was taken, was implemented in Champawat district of Uttarakhand. So this is one of the areas, Dharonj village, that is at 1,800 meter above mean sea level. And the other picture is from Gumor, that is at 1,000 meter at mean sea level. And you can see that species that are planted are belonging to different, right from oak species, that is climatic climax of this region, to some of the pioneers and some of the grass species, to support livelihood of this region has been also taken care of. So this plantation and restoration has not only helped improvement of land ecosystem benefits, but also helped in fodder production. That is 636 to 1,280 ton per hectare, improvement in soil fertility, reduced human drudgery, and income generation. That's part of alternate livelihood for this region. So this has been one of the success stories from the region, from the north part of the state, from central Himalayas. So this is very appreciative, and it has been also tried to be replicated in other parts of Himalayan districts and states. Now coming to the down south, because we have mangroves in the region at both eastern and western side. So the western mangroves are more of arid nature, arid and dry nature, whereas the eastern mangroves are mostly of very humid and wet nature. India has almost 4,921 square kilometer of mangroves, and this is about 3.2% of global mangrove cover. The Sundarban, that is also national park and World Heritage Site, has 43% of mangrove cover, whereas the west coast, the state of Gujarat, has almost 23% of mangrove cover. So in total, India has very rich and diverse mangrove cover. Some of the very biodiversity rich mangrove areas like Bhitarkanika in Odisha is also present on the coastal region of South Asia. And this study was supported and shared by MS Swaminathan Research Foundation of India, one of the old organization and very efficiently working on mangrove atlas and conservation and restoration of mangroves. This is a science-based, community-centered and process-oriented joint mangrove management model. And this model has tried to restore more than 3,000 hectares of degraded mangroves in Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, Odisha, and Maharashtra states in last more than a decade. So the restoration of degraded mangroves, for the purpose, this was the methodology that has been followed. First of all, they have identified suitable areas for mangrove restoration through GIS techniques, then obtaining permission for restoration by forest department, because most of the mangrove forest and other terrestrial forest are under forest department's jurisdiction, and there needs to be a permission if you want to restore or do any activity inside the forest type canals and plant mangrove in community in monitoring and restoration through fishbone care. It was carried out in the elevated region, and this is very significant because it follows the approach where you are modifying you are using the geographical area as an important knowledge base to improve and restore the area in a very scientific manner. Then both nursery raised and direct dibbling plantation of mangrove seeds and sapling was done. It was basically done by local communities, and nursery raised saplings in the canals and seeds between the canals. So that was the basic procedure while plantation. You can see some of the pictures. And these are some of the Lancet 5 and 1986 and the change in 2001, where a lot of coastal areas on the top and the bottom can be seen that has been restored. And you can see some of the pictures of some of the old mangrove plantation of 4 years or 5 years being depicted in the pictures. Now I'm coming to Gujarat, an arid part of the country, Rajasthan and Gujarat in India, where one of the issues is salinity ingress. So if you see the global estimates, after Australia, in North and Northern Asia and South Asia and South America are some of the regions where salinity is the major issue. Gujarat has a larger part under salinity ingress issues. This study was carried out by some of our CEM members and some of the young professionals. And if you see this case study, so the major approach was to understand what are the key soil index, soil criteria that can help us to understand how to improve soil fertility so that restoration becomes a success. So first of all, the soil was taken care of, understanding the physical chemical properties of soil and understanding the vegetation of the area by vegetation survey and soil sampling. So very popular Miyawaki plantation technique. Those who don't know Miyawaki plantation technique may try to Google. Miyawaki is a very Japanese way of plantation where you are using a very small area and planting it by some of the old nurse seedlings in a very condensed way to raise the forest in a very small span of time. So this heavy irrigation process was involved in reclamation of saline soil. And if you can see that it is necessary to identify and assess the key soil indicators. So that was the part of this entire project. And after plantation, the monitoring for spore post-plantation care was taken for second and third year of vegetation. And you can see significant increase in growth of trees that were planted. That shows the success of plantation. So for salinity, addressing salinity issues, electrical conductivity, porosity, pH, silt are found some of the critical soil indicators for this area. And this indicator can be used as a standard to assess the reclamation of restoration progress in the saline areas like the area that was studied under this project. And then they also tried to understand what are the important tree species that can improve soil quality. So Albizia libic, Casuarina equisetifolia, and Terminalia arjuna are some of the native species that were seen to help significant, and they were found to be significant key regulators in improving the soil sanity issues. This is one of the ecosystem services improvement project that is undergoing in central part of the India. I'll not go much in detail because I think I'm having short of time. So this project, the novelty of this project is that the changing the way of monitoring land degradation and desertification at the national level by setting up a web-based national system of monitoring. So this project is implemented in about 36 villages in Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh, and 35 villages in Chhattisgarh that are central part of India. And in this project, more than 25,000 hectare area has to be upscaled for sustainable land and ecosystem management. See, here are some of the indigenous ways of restoring this area because a lot of indigenous population is living in central part of India. So like Wadi system, that is more of using orchard development that gives some kind of economic benefits to communities. And on the boundaries, a lot of forestry species are planted. So that kind of establishes the proper system for livelihood benefits and restoration. Then there is one more system of choka system where a square is made for harnessing rainwater, harvesting rainwater. And so on three sides of this choka, there is 9-inch wall, and on the fourth side, it is open so that rainwater flows in a direction. And a lot of grasses are sown. So this entire practice is mostly in arid zone areas, and this helps in grazing and herder communities, and also helps in recharging groundwater aquifers. Apart from that, a lot of bamboo rehabilitation program where bamboo is used because this is also a livelihood supporting species, system of rice intensification, lac cultivation. Lac is a kind of insect that feeds on a lot of native trees and also supports livelihood because it gives is used as a dye in traditional system where leather and clothes and other things can be dyed by lac. Then eco-restoration and institutional strengthening at local level are important aspects of this program. Now coming to one of the similar kind of initiatives of developing fodder bank models from Uttarakhand, because fodder is one of the areas that that is leading to a lot of human drudgery, a lot of accidents, and a lot of socio-economic issues in the villages. A lot of death happened because of fodder issues. So a very interactive data gathering tools were employed. Detailed phytosociological investigation was developed. A lot of calendars were developed by people's consultation to understand at what season, what kind of dependence local communities are having on forest. So this was this model was in a very small localized 5 hectare of degraded area. So in this program, initially 2 years were spent for trust building among communities and plantation. A lot of experts were called to teach and build capacity of these women to understand what is the proper way of plantation of fodder crops, and also what will be the best way for a post-plantation care. A lot of free seedlings and plants were distributed to community and women especially. So you can see in 3 years, this was the kind of growth that model achieved. And the most important thing was the incentive given to some progressive farmers that helped to introduce this model to cropland bunds. In Himalayas, the bunds are very small. The cropland bunds are very small. So, but they can be used as alternative source of fodder. And the important part of this project was when local people started harvesting this fodder, started feeding to their animals, because even livestock is not a very modern breed. They started getting increase in their milk yields, and that improved their livelihood at certain extent. So this was one of the small case studies. And the sustainability of that project was that local women were more interested in introducing fast-growing, high biomass yielding grasses in their kitchen gardens and cropland bunds, along with the local bamboo species. And they regulated their visits to the forest and reduced also. So at the same time, they were using local Ringal bamboo to make some small articles and sell in the villages. And this also reduced their pressure on forest for fodder requirements. Now coming to one of the mining studies that we did in one of the biggest mines in Asia. And this was a zinc mine, and the intervention that was used was zero soil intervention. The reason was a lot of the soil from surrounding area is brought to these mine areas after mine closure so that a forest can be raised. But we tried to reduce this bringing soil from other sources and trying to improve the fertility of overburden by using mycorrhiza, NPK inputs, nitrogen, phosphorus and potassium input, and also stabilizing the landscape by using a lot of grasses. So the first thing was to understand what grows on this landscape. So a primary survey, what is actually growing, because these were one of the most surviving and acclimatized species. And then understanding the differences and comparative chemical physico-chemical properties of the soil, what kind of heavy metals are present, what kind of macronutrients are required, what kind of micronutrients are required for the soil. Based on this study, we decided. And the rehabilitation trials were decided based on almost 30 species that we planned to develop a biodiversity kind of setup. And these were decided based on our pot culture experiments, in-house pot culture experiments. And a successful intervention happened in 2015. And if you can see on one of the slides, there are a lot of plants kept above this mycorrhizal combination. So these are one of the threatened species, Commiphora victiae, that is also red listed by IUCN and has shown the best potential for these landscapes. And there was a good survival of overburden plantation, and some of the best performing species were further taken care of by next level of plantation by corporates. This is one of the last sites about Puliket Lagoon, that is the second largest brackish water lake in India, and at the same time very threatened. So the CEA members, by support from UN Habitat, World Urban Campaign, and GNDR, are trying to conserve this species and restore this area by developing a lot of community awareness initiatives and also trying to raise this awareness at international level so that this area can be conserved as a heritage and conservation priority area for the region. So the major lessons that we learned from all our studies and the success stories that we shared, that for South Asia, the preference has, first of all, to be given to community needs and requirements. Unless we target community needs and requirements and address them, we are not going to be successful to involve communities and indigenous people in our restoration programs. And that will be a mega challenge, because unless community gets involved, your success stories of restoration on ground cannot be created. The second important aspect was community livelihood support for poverty alleviation. So what kind of livelihood support is required? That should be the first part of restoration program. Traditional measures, of course, scientific measures are equally important, but at the same time, hearing to what communities are saying based on their years of traditional knowledge has to be well addressed. Effective, innovative technological input should be very much there. Community participation. At the same time, we also need to understand there are several such small level case studies that are spread across South Asia region. But the problems with upscaling has been policy interventions, governance issues. So that needs to be well addressed, because policy and local governance issues are sometimes very well highlighted at international level, but not well properly understood and implemented at national and local level. So this is the, I come to end of my, all the slides, and I would like to thank IUCN CEM, Department of Science and Technology, and other partners of Commission on Ecosystem Management. And I am thankful to Roke and Kara for giving South Asia CEM an opportunity to be part of this important webinar series. Thank you so much. And let me know if you have any questions, because I am sure we are very short of time. If you have specific questions, you can write to me. I'll be trying to answer on email. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Shalini. We do have quite a few questions that people have posed. Before we get to the questions, however, since we're right on the hour, I want to mention the theme of our August seminar session. It's a little different from our previous event in the webinar series, because we'll be having a discussion in August. And the discussion will be concerning the upcoming 2020 World Conservation Congress. This is IUCN's big forum to bring together all the entities within the union, as well as the member groups, to focus on the agenda for the next 4 years. There are several events being planned focusing on ecosystem restoration, including a thematic session, as well as, it's in the planning, so I'm hesitating, but we believe that we'll be able to offer a pavilion within the exhibition hall that is an active area for ecosystem restoration to bring together all the member groups and all IUCN. As part of the pavilion, we're organizing different events to focus on priority actions for the UN decade, ecosystem restoration, and the post-2020 targets. So in order to get feedback from our thematic group, as well as other entities and commissions within IUCN, we thought it would be a good idea to have a discussion. We invite you all to join us. We'll have everybody unmuted and hopefully have a thought-provoking and interesting session on how we can all effectively engage in this important forum. So with that, I will introduce the first question. If you need to leave, we're a couple minutes over the hour. Feel free to drop off the line. But for those of you who can stay, please type additional questions if you'd like in the chat box. We have about five right now. The first is from Rajiv Kumar Chaturvedi, who's a 14 member of the Forest Ecosystems Group of CM, and he's also an assistant professor at Birla Institute of Technology and Science in Goa, India. And Rajiv says, dear Dr. Shalini, thanks for the very informative presentation. Curious about land restoration goals of the South Asian countries. Well, recently, SDG progress by some of the South Asian countries, including India, is appreciated. Still, large challenges remain in the form of overpopulation and poverty. I would like to know your views about whether South Asian countries will be able to meet their land restoration, reversing land degradation goals.
Shall I answer?
Yes, please.
Yeah, just introducing, Rajiv is also the CEM co-chair for Forest Specialist Group. And I think what he has raised is very important because India was recently very much appreciated by UN for achieving and progressing toward achieving SDG goals. And also in terms of bond challenge, India is promising a lot with other South Asian countries like Pakistan and Bangladesh also to plant a lot of trees to restore a lot of land that is already degraded. While I focus on his question, what are my views if South Asian countries will be able to meet their land restoration? So I think sustainably addressing the urban challenges because our groundwater and population issues along with poverty are some of the very important issues to be addressed. At the same time, if we want to address land restoration issues, because our governments are promising a lot of forestation and that is well getting implemented on ground also, if we can also include a lot of post-plantation care in our agenda along with proper monitoring of what we are planting every monsoon season from July to September, I think we will be able to address a lot of and land restoration targets and also trying to reverse a few of land degradation goals while our population and poverty is, I mean, a challenge, but it is improving, I mean, subsequently. But post-plantation care and monitoring can be some of the measures that we can try to address and include in our governmental agenda to improve on reversing land degradation goals.
Great, thank you. Our next question is from Ondrila Basu, who is also a member of IUCN CM South Asia with a master's in forestry from Forest Research Institute. She works in mangrove restoration. And the question is rainwater harvesting along with restoration being considered in drought-prone zones? Zones affected with salinity and physiologically dry soils.
So I'll thank you, Andrila, for this very important question because India is undergoing a lot of groundwater challenges. But when I talk about rainwater harvesting, I will try to discuss it first with the perspective of rainwater harvesting. I'm sure you are well aware that many parts of South Asia and many states of India have made rainwater harvesting very mandatory. So like Kerala is there, UP recently started, and Maharashtra is also following up. Rainwater harvesting is becoming the important aspect when we are planning for conservation. And recently our Prime Minister has also talked about improving on rainwater harvesting. But when we talk about restoration, especially watershed area, catchment area treatment plant, that is when restoration and groundwater improvement and rainwater harvesting comes into totality. So far, it has not been addressed in a very defined manner, but slowly it is getting integrated to address issues like especially physiologically dry soil and drought-prone areas like in Gujarat and Rajasthan and many parts of Bangladesh. I hope it answers your question.
Yeah, thank you. Very interesting. Okay, I'm going to the next question. There's two similar, so I'll introduce both of them. Mi Hillebrand, who is a graduate student at Colorado State University in the U.S., asks, how do you get community buy-in and do local governments participate? And then there was another question by Marina that I think you can answer maybe together, which is how do communities organize to share benefits from restoration activities? And then after that, we have two more questions, and then we'll close the line since we're already a little bit over time.
Thank you, Kara. Yeah. I thank for both of these very important questions. The first by Margaret, I'll try to answer this. How do you get community buy-in? I think that's the toughest task in South Asia, to get community buy-in what you are proposing. So for that, because I've worked with community, and it took me almost 2 years to convince the community for fodder bank model to understand the benefits that it can bring to them in terms of ecosystem service benefits. But it took me almost 2 years. So that faith and to the interest to convince the community. So after 2 years, when certain members, they started getting benefits, that is what other community members were seeing. And that became one of the important motivations to buy this project, to buy this idea that I was trying to sell to them or developing fodder bank model. So this took me almost 6 to 7 years to develop and stabilize this project in that area. And when I talk about how do local governments participate, so once they see changes started happening, especially forest department and others, and they see that communities are no longer going to their forests so regularly and trying to improve their own resources by restoration, that is when government also thinks to participate. And not only local government, a lot of state and other countries also take it as an opportunity to see this kind of innovation. And second, answering the question of Murray, how as program results are reached, for example, biodiversity project has come to a conclusion, how the results and maintenance were ensured. Yes, that is one of the other important constraints when you are planning a long-term conservation project for an area. Because there has to be a sustainability of the project. So the important thing in South Asia, because there are a lot of local level governance systems, both formal and informal systems, and especially if a project is successful, a lot of communities are interested to get involved with them. But for that, we have to bring a certain more projects to keep that momentum on for like next 1 decade or so that community feels that benefits are flowing regularly. And then transferring this kind of projects to communities, and then regular monitoring are some of the ways to continuously monitor the continuity and maintenance of the results. And so this regular monitoring and understanding community perspective at every regular interval is a very important tool to understand that the restoration projects is going to remain for a longer time. And this is also the time when the results can be harnessed in the larger and better way. I hope I addressed your question.
Excellent. Thank you. The next question is from Mari from Lund, Sweden, as she's a sustainability and environmental studies student. And she says, Dr. Cellini, I'm interested in knowing how, as program results are reached, for example, biodiversity project in a certain region has come to a conclusion, how continuity and maintenance are ensured. And then in parentheses, she says that the land restoration biodiversity is going to remain that way and not be exploited in the future.
Kara, I think I answered this question in continuity with the last question.
Yeah. I agree. So let's go on to our very last question, which is it possible to have a South regional agroforestry policy which includes all the countries of the region, to ensure the support of the restoration projects you have presented? Which countries already have an agroforestry national policy in place?
Thank you, Rosa, for this question. Agroforestry is one of the important parts of agriculture, livestock-based economy of South Asia. And just to inform you, India was the host country for 2014 Agroforestry Congress by CGIAR. And India was one of the first countries who shared their agroforestry national policy in 2014. So we are having this national agroforestry policy in place and very much taking it at the next level by developing and promoting agroforestry interventions to show it as an important carbon sink that can also address and fulfill the NDCs of the country. So far India is concerned, I'm aware that agroforestry national policy is there, and it will be very important and interesting to see, have a regional agroforestry policy where other countries like Nepal is also one of the promoters and practitioners of developing agroforestry models and projects, and Bangladesh also. So that will be, and Bhutan as well. So it will be very important to have some kind of South Asia regional discussions and policy formulations where all countries have certain kind of agenda on developing and restoring agroforest at the larger level. But India certainly has its agroforestry national policy in place.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Shalini, for what was a fantastic presentation from your region. We really appreciate your participation and expertise, and especially your willingness to participate at a late hour where you live. And thanks to all the participants for joining and staying through the question and answer session. Please do take a minute to complete the survey, and if possible, to list ideas for presentations you would like to see in 2020. Over the next few months, we'll be assembling the webinars for the next year. And if there are topics that you would like to present, or emerging ideas that you would like an in-depth presentation, please list them and we can try to work them into the schedule for the next year. We will see many of you in the webinar in August to plan for the World Conservation Congress. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much, Brooke and Kara.
Thank you very much for your time, Shalini. It was a wonderful presentation.
Thank you. And good night, everyone from India.